All right, so hi everyone, what's up? Well, first of all, many thanks, Melvin, for organizing the conference. I know it's, well, a ton of work, so congrats. And well, also thank you to all the sponsors and to my teammates of Mystico for making this conference possible. And of course, thanks for letting me talk about my weird Kubernetes stuff. So this is the title of the talk, Hacking Kubernetes 101. This talk is intended to be a more or less beginner friendly talk. Just to make people a little more aware about this, the security issues and the way to fix them in this kind of environments, which are nowadays more popular than ever. So, first of all, I would like to introduce a little bit myself. I'm Daniel Monzón. Starcode. In Telegram and Twitter and so. I work as a full-time pen tester from sometime now. Also, I like to hand CVs from time to time. with Melvin, I do it, we used to hand them as well. Also, I like to write some security tools. This is kind of a thing I started recently. The NGX Founder is just one of them. So, enough for the who am I. Okay, so let's start with the talk. First of all, for those who don't know Kubernetes or what's Kubernetes for, etc. Kubernetes, it's an orchestrator. I believe it was developed by Google, if I don't remember wrong. And the main idea behind this is to manage containers, to automate deployments, a lot more stuff. So, and to scale, to scale many stuff. Kubernetes, it has they have a lot of different uses. So this is here. I don't know if you can see my mouse, but okay. Here in the left, it's the schema of a typical Kubernetes environment. Okay. Each of these nodes. First of all, it is the schema is divided between the master node, which is like the one containing all the main components. Without this, none of these can run. And these are the worker nodes. In the actual containers, the deployments you can do, etc. They are run here on the master nodes. So let's talk a little bit about the components of the master node first. So here, what you can see, etcd is a distributed storage in a key value format, which is used by default in Kubernetes environments. So all the interesting stuff, this is like the MySQL or Postgres for Kubernetes. You can think about it that way. The rest of the stuff here in the master node, it's the scheduler. The scheduler assigns the pods to the nodes. Here are the pods. As you can see, a pod can contain more than one container, but normally there's just a container per pod. So, the scheduler just assigns the pods to the different nodes. The API server, as you can see here, it's like the heart of the Kubernetes environment. It talks actually to everything, and almost everything talks to it. This API server, as you can guess, it has an APIs, an API, and it's one of the things to be aware of if you want to harden a little bit your environment. More stuff. The Cloud Controller Manager. Yeah, this Cloud Controller Manager, it's optional in case you are running your cluster on the cloud. For instance, there are services like Google Kubernetes Environment, and I think AWS, I remember, it has also a way to host your cluster there. So this is the way it interacts with the cloud. And also the controller manager, this just watches for the nodes to be active, the jobs, it creates service accounts, a lot of stuff. Okay. And here you have the worker nodes. In each node, there is an agent called Kubelet that is running, and it has an API too that we will check out later. The Kubelet, it interacts with the pods, and this Kubelet API, it's also a very typical way to compromise. To compromise a lot of containers. Also, this CAdvisor, it's like a metric thing, which is also exposed, and we will see it later as well. And the kubeproxy is the component which is actually responsible for exposing services to the internet. And in the at the low level thing, the container, in the runtime it used to be Docker. But now it is Containerd because Docker, it is built on the top of Containerd, so it was a nonsense. The service thing that I mentioned before that kubeproxy is in charge of is exposing services, which are just a set of pods, to the internet as a network service, as a typical TCP port or whatever. And we will see later why is exposing services not always the best idea. So as an introduction, enough, I think. So let's start with the possible attacks. So these are the external attacks which are possible. The main ways to compromise the cluster are via the API server. If this API is exposed to the internet, there are a lot of chances that you can use it to compromise the cluster. The exposed dashboard, that it's more typical than you would think. And in fact, many enterprises have been compromised because of this. The Kubelet API, which I mentioned before. And just what I told you about compromising internet facing services. Okay. From the attacker perspective, what we would look for is all of this. This is a list of all the ports, which are default ports in a Kubernetes environment. The API server, as you can see, it's a very typical port, but you need to check this is the API server, of course. The etcd, which is one of the hardest to compromise from the outside, but it is still possible. The CAdvisor, the metrics I told you, the API server, this Minikube thing. Minikube is a way to contain your own cluster within just one machine in a I think it was VirtualBox, using VirtualBox. This is another port without HTTPS. The Kubelet API, this is very typical, and this is useful once you are inside a cluster. It's useful to scan everything to look for this API. Because as I told you, it's a little bit complicated to harden at least one by one. Also, yeah, the another kubelet API, the kubeproxy thing, this is almost useless normally. And these two things I think are optional, so that's it. Okay. So first of all, this Kubernetes thing is not something I invented today. This is something, well, that it's starting to get well, more popular, etc. And even Microsoft has created a Mitre-like attack matrix, I guess we could say, specifically for Kubernetes environments. So here you can say you can see all, well, these are not exactly all the ways, but many of them, yes. The ways you can get initial access, for instance, the cloud thing, these images in registry. This is something, well, I will talk about in the last slides. Well, an exposed dashboard, an exposed API, etc. Ways to be persistent. For instance, well, a malicious container. Well, this is another thing we will talk about later. A Kubernetes cron job, which is an object in Kubernetes which runs a command in a container every certain amount of time. Well, a lot of stuff. As you can see, this is something well, which is becoming more popular. And there are even well, very recent books which have been written just for this purpose. And there's also like OWASP-like method for this as well, in case you are you like methodologies and all that stuff. Okay, so what's this? This is a Kubernetes dashboard. This is very typical. Every time you launch, you create a cluster and so, this is created as well. This you can control, obviously, if you expose it to the internet or not. In, well, a lot of occasions, you will find that this dashboard isn't even protected with a simple login. So you can just go right away and you can go to workloads over here, click on pods and directly execute code in a pod and get a shell just like that, for instance. And you could even automate this to make the cluster, the whoever's cluster, your botnet, for instance. So this is a very bad practice. Okay. So to interact with the kubelet API. All right. Well, maybe I should have explained the other, well, there is a command line interface tool very very known, which is kubectl. That's the general one, but this one, this kubelet_ctl, it's designed to specifically talk to the kubelet APIs. Well, as you know, there is a kubelet agent running in each of the nodes, in each of the worker nodes, and it's very intuitive. I mean, it's very easy to use. Or you can even, well, talk to the API using curl or wget or whatever. Okay, so for instance, you can see here how to get information about the running pods. This is a big info leakage in case this is not protected. And here with this API call, you can just directly get a shell into the, well, not get a shell, but execute commands inside a container in the node. So it's not, you know, very good idea to leave this unrestricted. Also, you can check out the logs the logs, well, there, it's just logs. I mean, you can find there whatever is being sent without protection, the tokens, cookies, IDs. For instance, there's also the token. Sometimes you can find the token, which is introduced once you launch the kubeadm command, which is the command you use when you're creating a cluster. Okay, very very bad idea to leave this like open to everyone. Also, the etcd API. This is the one I told you. It's really difficult to compromise because you need normally a certificate of authority and many stuff. You need these two files. Obviously, if you can manage to disclose them via, for example, a directory traversal in Exposed Service or whatever, then you can just exploit this remotely. Or even if you are compromised, whatever service, and you end up with a shell, with a reversal, maybe you can do some tricks in case you have had the luck to land on the master node. By magic, you can also launch all of these commands. As I mentioned before, this etcd thing, it's just a database. It's just a database, and you can dump all the information in the database, like with this command. And with that, we will see a little bit later why this database in general, some of the stuff which is stored in this database is not secure by default. And we will see a bit later this stuff. Okay. Okay, it's filtering the files, perfect. Okay, so post-exploitation. With a shell, no, inside a container, which is in a worker node, then we can start looking around, finding a way to compromise the whole cluster. Normally, you will end up just in a worker node, right? So there may be a lot of other pods, a lot of other containers, a lot of other worker nodes, and the master node, which is the key one. And we want actually to compromise all of them. And this is a little bit of the commands you would use to do a little recon inside the Kubernetes cluster. First, you will check cgroups to check if you are in a Kubernetes cluster. And once you have confirmed it, you can go for this. This is a bad thing which is enabled by default. Yes, and that's that thing is just the service for a default service account token is mounted in every container. So normally you could just check out which stuff is mounted and get the token. And with this token, you can use it to communicate to the API server. And it depends on the exact privilege, but maybe you could use it also to communicate to the kubelet APIs in case they are restricted in some way. Okay, so more stuff. We want to communicate to the API server, but we don't know exactly how. We could try to do it with curl, but it is a little bit of pain to try trying that. So we would try to locate the kubectl command. And if we cannot find this binary, we could also manage to download it into the reversal we have. Also credentials, SSH keys, database, etc. Normally, the containers, because they are containers, many developers think they are secure by default. So because we are in a container, you cannot escape. I don't care if you get credentials or if I get an SSH key. This is a really common thing and a bad practice, okay? Because it's very, sometimes, for instance, the network configuration with the, I think it was host network, I don't remember exactly the name. There is a parameter in the manifests used to deploy pods, which actually let you communicate to the network of the worker node, and that's often misconfigured. So you know, SSH keys, all that stuff, whatever you are storing in the container, assume an attacker is going to be able to use it somehow. Also, use kubehunter or some of the tools. Well, we will see later which of the tools I use normally for this. Also trying to exec to the rest of the pods, modify deployment in case we want to create a malicious deployment, replica sets, gain persistence with cron jobs. And as a normal network pentest, scanning whatever we have in our network, etc. Sniff traffic, that's also important. And also just enumerating the privileges we have. The idea is to gain get the token, which I mentioned before, this one, and then with the auth CANI operation, we can see exactly what permissions we do have. And there are a lot of ways to compromise a cluster with a misconfigured permission, with cluster role bindings, cluster roles, and a lot of stuff. So enough for the theory. This is an example of a post-exploitation enumeration. So let's check it out. Okay, so we are root in a container, which is actually, many developers think that's useless. Of course not. Okay, so we confirm we are in a Kubernetes environment. This is what I mentioned before about the service account token. Yep. So there you go. It's just a JSON web token. So we don't have kubectl in the machine, which is a pity, but as I told you, we can just go to a writable location, like temp. And we can just download it. Okay, perfect. So we give executable permissions And now we can start enumerating which permissions the, well, we have by default. We could also try, well, by default, we had a lot of permissions. We could also include the token. We have discovered to check exactly the permissions the token has. We could also use automated tools. Well, those ones, I will show them later. You can do a lot of stuff from here. So for instance, you can list pods. And this permission is critical. And yes, we can create pod as well. This create pod operation is a very typical way to compromise the whole cluster once we are inside. Okay. We could also list the nodes, I think. So this nodes thing, we need to specify the namespace thing to get the result, I think. Get nodes. Okay, perfect. All right. So that's what an attacker would normally do after compromising a container. Okay. So about the etcd thing I mentioned before, some of the stuff which is stored there is insecure by default. I was talking about secrets. Secrets are, well, as you can see here from the Kubernetes docs, they are just values which are base 64 encoded strings, and you can get them as plain text, and you can get almost everything from passwords to API keys to whatever important information that it's stored there. You can get the list of the secrets with this operation here. And then you can get the exact values of the secrets with this. Okay, let's have a look. All right. So there, we can list the secrets. And we can get exactly the details of the secret with this command. Okay, perfect. Okay, so that's it. So that's the base64 encoded secret. So here you can see why this is completely insecure by default. Okay, perfect. I think it's, nothing left. Okay, let's see. So I need to introduce here the concept of namespaces because here, what we've done, it's list the secrets and get the contents of one of the secrets in the default namespace. When you create a Kubernetes cluster, you create the default namespace, and well, some others are created, but then you can create some more. These namespaces are just virtual clusters inside a physical cluster. Well, not necessarily physical, but you get the idea. Okay, so here you can see the names, all the namespaces which are public in this cluster. And here are the same ones we got before, which are the ones in the default namespace. You don't need to specify it by default, it get this command without this, you get the default values, the default namespace secrets. And then if you specify a different namespace, you can get the secrets of the other namespaces. For example, we can get here API keys, etc. Which is something which is very bad practice is allowing almost anyone to access the secrets in the cube system namespace. The cube system namespace is a special one because in the secrets of that specific namespace are stored the tokens of service account with very high roles assigned, with very privileged role bindings. So a very bad idea. Once you get it, almost game over for the Kubernetes cluster. So for the internet exposing thing, there are many ways, many objects in Kubernetes which allow you to expose stuff to the internet. There are ingress, there are many others. The two main ones to expose a set of pods as a network service are these two, the node pods and the cluster IP. The cluster IP, as you may have guessed by these internal IPs, it isn't exposed to the internet. It listens like a network service internally, and it is very typical. And the node port thing are the ones actually exposing stuff to the internet. So once you are inside the cluster, you should also check which node ports are active and try to compromise them to get to different pods, etc. Okay. So access to the machine node from a pod. First you can try to find bugs in the pod, that's weird. But what you can do, for example, I mentioned before the create pod permission. First of all, this file here, it's a manifest used to to create a pod. Okay, so here if you have this permission, you can just mount the host, okay, so the worker node file system, you can mount it inside this folder. So once you create this pod, you can get a shell into it and just read for example this etc password file. Also, there is a field which is node name, which lets you specify in which node you want to create this pod. This is a very a very good way to compromise the cluster, because you can specify here just the name of the master node. So once you are in the master node, you have access almost to everything. So you can do this and get access to the file system of the master node. Okay. So more stuff over here. Here you can see with this very long command. We are just getting the manifest of a pod. Okay, In this case, this one, this is the monitor deployment thing. And then we're getting these fields, which is the privilege one, the host process ID, host network. This host network is the one, the field that I mentioned before that lets you communicate with the network of the worker node. Host path, etc. So here you can see it's all enabled, everything set to true. So this is a terrible configuration. So the way to restrict all this stuff, well, the old ways with pod security policies. Now I think they've changed it, but I'm not sure. I think this one is the old one. And you can also, as another way to harden this a little bit is to enable various admission controllers. This blog post from Bishop Fox, it's very makes different examples of how multiple combinations of these settings can lead to different interesting things for an attacker. So if you have privilege equal to true, if you have host IPC, host network, well, all of these ones have some useful, it's just loot for for a pen tester. So, okay, let's go to the next one. Okay, more stuff that can be attacked on a Kubernetes environment. You can attack Helm, which is the package manager for Kubernetes, well, the most known one. This one, it's not uncommon to attack it. Also, if you are in a cloud, in whatever cloud, if you are in Google Cloud or if you are in AWS, wherever you are in the cloud, you should know all that stuff that you are using in the cloud can be used in some ways against you. For instance, I think you could try to query the instance metadata thing in a worker node, because actually, for instance, in AWS, the AKS, the Elastic Kubernetes Service, I believe, it's just a lot of EC2 machines. So you can get credentials querying the instance metadata service and leverage that to compromise, IAM accounts and whatever, a lot of stuff. So you need to take this into account. The cAdvisor thing can also leak some information. So, this is the thing I was talking about, the instance metadata thing. In AWS Elastic Kubernetes Services, and also in Compute, I believe they're called Computing Giants, like the equivalent to EC2, but in Google Cloud Platform. So the same metadata thing Google uses. Okay, so from the defensive side, you have different authorization modes to restrict access to several things. You can restrict the stuff from each node with the node authorization. That one, I've never seen it in a real environment. The attribute one, as well, I think it's rare. The role-based access control, that's the most used one as I've seen. And this role-based one, it's you need to configure it correctly. I mean, for instance, developers tend to they tend to give the cluster admin role to almost every service account just in case. And that's a horrible practice. So, well, there you go. And the webhook one as well, there you can check it out in the documentation, the official documentation. Okay, so hardening stuff. Now that we know how to break a Kubernetes environment, we need to also know how we could harden this. We could try, as I told you before, to put in place some admission controllers, which are just stuff which are between whatever calls the API server and the API server. You can establish network policies. Obviously, as well as establishing network policies, you need to check the host network field in the manifests of the pods manifests. Also, you should disable the automatic mounting of the service account token. You can encrypt secrets. You don't need to leave them just there as base64 stuff. You can, there's a feature to encrypt them at rest. And also, well, disabling all the anonymous access to everything. Disabling the anonymous access to the API server, to the kubelets APIs, etc. And here you have more stuff you should check out. If you use a role-based authorization, you should check the roles, the existing roles, the role bindings. The role bindings, they are just objects, both the class, well, the role bindings are just objects that assign a role to a specific account. And the cluster roles, it's the difference with between the cluster role and the normal roles is just that the roles only give you permission in a certain namespace, and the cluster role, I believe, it gives you permissions in the whole cluster, so all the namespaces that exist. So what I was saying before, do not assign this without checking out which account you assign it to. Do not grant this verb, the escalate one, to almost any account. Also, you should not specify the privilege true field in the pod manifest. And also, you don't need to run containers as root. There are many containers which are run as root just because that's easier and you don't get permission errors. And so, but you can also specify the run as user and run as group fields in the pod manifest to restrict a little bit the permissions it has. Also, if you don't need to write the stuff, you can declare the file system of the container as a read-only file system. Well, a lot of stuff. Do not enable the insecure port thing in the API server, or otherwise you will expose it to the internet. Well, there are many, many stuff. For instance, this is all the stuff you need to check with the Kubernetes dashboard. Never use these flags, the skip login, the authorizer settings, or otherwise you will find that someone someone has been messing around your dashboard in Shodan. There are a lot of these environments in Shodan, and well, I think also you can find them with Google Docs and well, a lot of stuff. Also, well, this is a little bit old, but check the images, obviously. Don't only harden the configuration of the Kubernetes, also check the images you use for your containers. Well, disable the impersonation, obviously. Review the jobs and the cron jobs. The cron jobs are, as I told you, a very good way to get persistence. So check those as well. check the node ports, the ingresses and the load balancers, but the, as the most common object to expose stuff are node ports, check your node ports, the ones you are you have enabled. And well, and this is just stuff for the for OS level. So okay, so tools of the trade. Okay, there are many different tools. These ones are the ones I knew some time ago. There are many others. As I told you, this is a growing topic. So there are many more tools coming out, not every day, but well, you understand what I'm saying. So this is a list of some of them. The ones I personally use and I like are KubeStriker and UVScan. This one is very easy to use. You just run a Docker container and almost that's it. So a very good way to get an initial checklist done for a pen test, in case you are in a pen test and you need to, well, yes, that to pen test a Kubernetes environment. Okay, so that's it. As you can see here, what you can see here are all the objects that exist in the Kubernetes environment. So we will see bindings, we have seen namespaces, nodes, pods, well, secrets, service accounts, services, but there are a lot. There are a lot of objects and there are surely many ways to take advantage of many of them. So this is a growing field and I invite everyone who likes all this stuff to get deep into the internals of Kubernetes and find new ways to break this thing. So this is a little bit of a challenge. So, well, that's all for me now. So any questions, and hope you like the talk, of course.